Hello. Good evening. Hope you're good. And I mean that in more ways than one, that your health is good. I also hope that you are good, right? There's a lot of different implications, a lot of connections that you can bring to the question, is it good? Is it good? So tonight we had something really good. We had meatloaf that Joanne made, and she also put some red potatoes in an air fryer, and had that with some watermelon and some salad. It was really, really good. So hi, Sierra. Glad you're on here. Thank you for the wave. So awesome. Hey, so tonight, as we get into our devotion, I ramble a little bit too much sometimes, don't I, when I get started on this? I watched a presentation about a couple days ago and looked at the comments underneath it, and a person said they ramble for about 3 minutes before they actually get into the important stuff. In other words, they were saying, if you don't want to waste your time, just skip ahead, because they're talking jargon, right? So, but I don't know, I think that's pretty valuable, right? It's one way to connect, you know, and get to ask questions. And so my question is, what have you had for lunch today, or dinner, or breakfast? Hopefully you've eaten something so far, and whatever it is, would love to hear what it is, and was it good, right? And that's another great point to the word good in and of itself. Some people would say McDonald's is good, right? Hey, when I was 13 years old, and when they first came out with the Monopoly game, McDonald's was so good. It was hash browns. It was not just the supersized fry, it was the bucket of fries. They literally had called it a bucket of fries. It was like this big. And for, I think it was $2, you just got this massive amount of McDonald's French fries. And man, that was good. That was good. When I was 14 years old and you did not feel the McDonald's after you ate it, that was some good stuff. So, Joanne's looking at me over here onto the side, so, I could put the camera on her to mess with her, but I'm not going to do that. So, hey, Cindy, glad you're on here. Hey, brother Matt, love you, bro. Hey, so those of you who watch this either now or later, please keep my brother in your prayers. He broke his hand, his left hand, actually. Not his primary hand, but he fractured it, and fractured it like a champ, right? Like a good man would fracture his hand, right? There's ways that men can fracture their hand that's like not good stories. For instance, if you ever watched the show The Office, there's a scene in there where a guy named Andy Barnard gets so angry he punches his hand through a wall, and then he says, "That was an overreaction." and then he ends up going to anger management classes. My brother Matt, he broke his hand because he was playing football with his oldest son, Nick. And his son threw a pass that caused him to lay out, right, to jump to try and catch it. As he jumped, tried to catch it, he fell on his hand, and crushing it in some fashion where he ended up breaking it. So, sorry, Matt, no wrestling for at least 6 or 7 weeks as you repair. So prayers appreciated for him. Prayers appreciated for Jamie Bentz. I haven't heard from her recently that she's out of the hospital now. But we have heard that her surgery was successful. So that is great news. And so, let's pray for her. If you have a prayer need, as we close tonight, I'd love to lift up anything that may be going on with you or your family, so feel free to share that. Tonight we're going to continue the theme that we carried a couple weeks back, where we're just going to tap into the scripture, study its wisdom, that we would be able to apply it into our lives. So we've just been doing this very generally as well. There's so many topics that we could cover, especially with the times that we're living in, but I've kept it very basic intentionally for the time being, but we might start stepping into some particular topics and areas that we'd want to cover. We are entering into the political season, and even the scripture itself would have some direction for us on how we ought to pursue wisdom, to, you know, encourage us how to vote, how to live in these times, where we live in a time where people can really get enraptured in politics, get consumed by it. I think it gets a little intense, a little more intense every year, that I pay attention to what's going on in politics and find people getting in a deeper and deeper despair, because they spend so much time, and then their thoughts aren't exactly, when you step into the arena of politics and just all that it is, I think it's fair to say the mess that it is today, it can wreck us, it can ruin us a bit, and so I don't think God wants that for our lives. He doesn't want us to be absent, He doesn't want us to not care, but He's got some good things to say really about anything. So let me put it out to you, whether you're watching this now or later, if you have a particular topic where you're like, man, I'd really love to know what the scripture has to say in the wisdom of applying in this arena of life, please, throw a comment up or message me on Facebook, and we should be able to cover that down. The Bible covers, there's not been a topic yet that I haven't been able to find that the Bible doesn't cover it, so it's the living Word of God, and we can go into pretty much anything where we're at in life to learn from it. So, all right, let's pray. We're going to learn at least 6 wisdoms. I'll give you an invitation to, we can go into anything else as well. But let's begin with prayer. So, Father, we love you this night. We thank you for the song of birds. We thank you for air to breathe. We thank you for the day that we have been able to live today. We thank you for each day that you give to us, and that we have always the option and the choice to make to be able to live for you. We pray that as we study your word tonight, Lord, that we would be refreshed by it, that we would be strengthened. We pray that your Holy Spirit would lead this time, teaching us, Lord, something new from your heart. Lord, I pray for my brother Matt. I just pray your healing over him in Jesus' name, and both he and Jamie Bentz. We just pray for their recovery, that you would surround them, Lord. And we pray for all others who need your touch, Lord, upon their life. Your healing in Jesus' name. And we ask for that not only physically, but we also ask, Lord, that there's many people who are in need of emotional healing. Lord, to be touched in the mind, Lord, that they would be brought into health. So we read in your word just this last Sunday that those who keep themselves in you find your perfect peace. So may those who need your perfect peace to find it in. And we just pray your revelation in their lives, that it can be found through you. We love you, and we say these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Hey, well, same invitation as was given from 2 weeks ago. If you have any chapter in the Bible where you'd say, man, I'd love to know actually what the wisdom could be gleaned from this specific chapter, just give any chapter in the Bible. And so we're studying from the Wisdom Bible tonight, right? So I spent 5 years compiling together notes of asking one specific question. What is the wisdom, Lord, that you would want man to hear from you for us to be able to build into our lives the direction, the way that you want us to go? So tonight we're going to start with 1 Corinthians 13. So any chapter you want, if there's one you think of, and I mean, I'm telling you, any chapter, you can go into Leviticus, Chronicles, make it hard, right? Make it, that's, for me, that'd be the fun of this. Make it hard for me. Give me a chapter where I was like, man, how can you find some kind of applicable wisdom in this chapter? But we're going to begin with 1 Corinthians 13, because last couple weeks ago, Cindy, and probably not Cindy, it was likely Brian, he said, 1 Corinthians 13, do 1 Corinthians 13. And I mean, so he asked for like a half hour commenting, saying, do that one. And I didn't end up doing it. So Brian, whether it was you or whether it was Cindy, I'm sorry that I did not do 1 Corinthians 13, but we're going to make that our first one tonight, stepping in, okay? Now, if you're not familiar with 1 Corinthians 13, this chapter is famously known as the love chapter. And I think I was at church camp, actually at Wellspring Four Square church camp. Paul Mackey is on here right now. Paul, God bless you. Man, love you. You had a significant impact on my life as a pastor. And Joanne and I are 17 years married now and still together. So we're living in Florida, man. Can you believe that? So I learned that 1 Corinthians 13 is called the love chapter back when I was, I think, 16 or 17 years old. And so this is in terms of chapters even that Hollywood quotes. I would say this is pretty accurate. Hollywood even loves to quote this chapter from 1 Corinthians 13 because it gives a very specific detail as of to what love is, what it looks like, how it's lived out as we seek to love others. Okay? But for the wisdom in this, before we go to that outline of wisdom, there's a verse first that I want us to consider to help us attach to the wisdom. Okay? And the wisdom is loving like a man, right? Or loving like a woman, like a mature believer. Loving like a mature believer. Okay, so verse 11 in 1 Corinthians 13 says this: when I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. Quick question for you, right? Has there ever been times in adulthood that you wish you could go back to childhood and relive moments differently, where it's like, man, now that I'm an adult, I regret that I did things the way I did as a child, right? Man, without throwing myself under the bus too much, man, I love my mom. She did an incredible job raising me. She was a prayerful woman. She provided for our family. She was a single mom. She worked a lot. She kept the house clean. Man, she did everything. She did everything. And she did it out of love. I know that, like, now, right? But when I was a child, and when I reasoned like a child, and when I thought like a child, to me, there were times where it was like there was never enough of mom's love, or she didn't love me the right way, because if she loved me, this is how she would love me. She would let me do what I want to do and let me have freedom in my life to do whatever I pleased, right? That's the thought of a child, right? You love me, you're going to let me do this. And in maturity, you know, thank God I had a mature mom. I had a strong mom who said, oh, you want to do that, but that's no good for your life, and I want to lead you lovingly into what is good for your life. And sometimes, man, I hated her for it. I despised her for it. I yelled at her for it. I said things that I'd regret now as a 37-year-old man, where moments in time was like, man, if I could go back and not say that to my mom, I'd take the opportunity. Do you get what I'm saying? Right, you've been there, so angry with your parent, and part of that had to do with how we reasoned as children. We wanted things that children want. You know, we wanted the best cake and dessert and foods that we wanted to eat. We wanted the best toys. We wanted to watch our TV shows. We wanted to play with our friends. We wanted to do things our way, and we couldn't wait to be an adult so that we could do whatever we wanted without anybody's, anybody's rule or authority. Right? That's why. Why do you have to be my parent and not let me do what I want? So I love my mom. She had a healthy balance in those things. She gave me a lot of freedom, but at the same time, she did provide good structure. So 1 Corinthians 13, okay? Verse 11, when I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. In other words, what Paul is saying here is when I matured, I got a healthy view of love and what love actually is. Man, this makes me think too of this reality. When you were a young kid or a teenager and you said to your parents, I found somebody and I am in love with them. I love them. And they're like, do you really know what love is? What is love? Do you understand that? And well, man, I like them. They're so easy to talk to and they're so beautiful, so handsome, so attractive, and they're everything I've been looking for in a person. It's like, oh, okay, well, so you love them. But a bigger question is, do you know how to love them? So they're able to fill your bank account. You're able to look at them and you like looking at them and you like talking to them and they fill your bank account. But here's the question that, you know, on your side of things, that while you are a reciprocator or you're a receiver of love, are you able to give that back out in such a way? And what is love ultimately, right? Love is not as much what we get as much as it is supposed to be what we give, right? A famous quote that comes around Christmas time, it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. And when it comes to love, this is absolutely true. You know, so when it talks about loving, when you're in love with somebody, that's one of the keys, is it isn't just about you're so happy with that relationship. It's, man, I want to be with this person. I want to bless them because, man, I'm so alive with them, and something ignites in me that I want to pour my life out to live a good life with them, right? Does that make sense? That's what Jesus did for us. He poured his life out for us in love, in sacrifice, because of his love for us. And so if you want to know what the definition of love is, man, you just look at Jesus and what he gave for us, what he did for us, okay? So moving forward now, and actually coming back in 1 Corinthians 13. So what is the definition of love? What is love? And so we're given many pieces here, and I'd say this is not an exhaustive list, but it's at least a strong list. It's a beautiful list of here's what love is. It says love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Love is not puffed up. Love does not behave rudely. It does not seek its own. It is not provoked. It thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. So again, not an exhaustive list, right, of what love is. I mean, this would be a great question, right? If you were to do a fill in the blank, if you were to write in, man, love is, what would you write in there? For me, one I would add to this list is love is sacrificial. Love is sacrificial. It gives a close word to that where it talks about love suffers long. It goes through a lot, right? Man, I've been married for 17 years now to Joanne, and man, she is an incredible woman. And I can tell you this, right, is testament that there's been days that Joanne has had to suffer long with me because of some days that the man that I am, that I don't listen to her as well as I should on some days. I don't give her the time and attention that she deserves and that she should have. On all days, maybe on more days than not, right? I mean, I could go into a whole list of the mess that I am as a man. And man, so I'm just so thankful that when I look at my bride Joanne, it says love suffers long. that, man, that's true of her with me. And I hope that perhaps you have somebody like that in your life, right? Whether it's a friend or a spouse, you know, somebody who suffers long with you, because we all have our short fallings. Man, it's like, are our short fallings not like out there for all the world to see in the mess that humanity is today in general? And all right, so love suffers long, love is kind. And so we could grab a hold of this chapter, and when it comes to applying its wisdom into our life, one of the questions that we can ask very directly is, okay, here's what the Bible is defining what love is. So here's the question to me. Am I these things, right? Am I one who suffers long? Am I one who is kind? Am I one who does not envy, but and not puffed up? You know, do I not go around parading myself and behaving rudely? And so putting yourself into that space of self-judgment, right? Because you don't want to be self-condemning, right? But there's a health in which you could look at your own life to judge yourself and ask whether or not you are living up to the person that you would hope to be. And most of all, the hope is, you know, as for me as a believer, in saying that you find that person not in what you would hope your own identity to be, but what Jesus's call over a person's life would be, you know, to walk in his love and his righteousness and his truth. And so, but with this list of love, we can put ourselves into it and ask that question, man, am I seeking at least to live the definition of love? Is Josh one who suffers long? Is Josh one who is kind? And so on and so forth. And we're the ones who live with ourselves. Hopefully we would know better than most as we ought to love and ought to live in what we do. Okay? All right. So if my mom, if you watched this sometime and you heard what I said earlier, man, I love you so much. Thank you for your investment into my life and the love that you gave to me. So hi, Heather, and hi, Chaplain Shipman. God bless you both tonight. I'm glad that you're here. And so, okay, we're going to press in now forward. The next chapter we're going to go to is Acts chapter 7. And I'm going to speed these up now. That was a good one. I wanted to center on that one for a bit, because Cindy and Brian had asked for the love chapter, and I never got to it a couple weeks ago, so I wanted to take some time for them on that one. All right, Acts chapter 7. This was a request given by Christian, okay? Now, this one being a little shorter, if you've never read Acts chapter 7, this is one of the most awesome chapters in the Bible, in my opinion. And the reason being is there's this incredible man of God. His name is Stephen. He's the first martyr of the Christian faith, where he is stoned as he is trying to share Jesus to those who hated him and were persecuting him. And before Stephen was stoned, he gave an address, which is called the Call of Abraham, in Acts chapter 7, and because people had come against him. They accused him of blasphemies and saying things that were false, which were just false accusations being put against him, much the same as they had put against Jesus. And so Stephen rises up to the occasion where people are accusing him falsely, and what he does in that moment is he actually gives this synopsis, this history of the Israelite people, you know, for the thousands of years that they lived. And if you've never read this chapter, Acts chapter 7, man, I want to encourage you to read it tonight, right? Before you go to bed. It's a longer chapter, and it, because it speaks to who the patriarchs were in Egypt with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and then how God delivered Israel through Moses' hand, and then God's goodness to Israel. Yet Israel continually rejected God because they were a mess, right? And that's just true of any nation and any people, that it's like, man, God can be good to us, but in terms of us actually returning, you know, the love to him that he gives to us. Man, that's done through the Spirit and us, you know, through the Holy Spirit living in us and us living that out. Not done by our own power, but done through God's power living in us to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. So, but Stephen also talks about this God's true tabernacle, right? Of how God made his place among the people of Israel. You know, and even though God did that, now Israel resists the Holy Spirit. It resists God's presence among them. And they quite literally did this too just recently, from when this chapter is in the timeline of history, with Jesus lived in their midst, right? They literally had God in the flesh living with them. They rejected him. They denied him. They crucified him. And so Stephen gives this very cutting history of, man, open your eyes and see how good God has been to you, yet you have rejected him. That's kind of the summation of Stephen's story. And, you know, this causes me to ask the question, right, that for us, that if God has given us a history, his operation, you know, in the world, and that can be sought out and pursued in many different facets. None better than the Bible itself, as the Israelites were God's chosen people to reveal the nature of God and his presence among people for thousands of years. And so I love that Stephen, right? He has a firm knowledge of God and his works in history. Okay, and that's the key here in terms of the application of wisdom for ourselves. Big question for you is, do you know history and do you know it from such a perspective that you can look back and be able to say, man, look, it's so clear. The operation of God was in the midst of these things. And then being able to use that as a witness and a testimony to the world to declare to the world. Because one of the common sayings today among people who don't believe in God is that God is dead. You know, he's not interacting with mankind anymore. You know, there is no such thing as God, right? But man, if you look back on history and the history of humanity, there's so much evidence, you know, to God's operation in the midst of things as you look at the track line and where everything has gone. And there's not enough time right now to go into that. Maybe that could be a topic. Like, that's a question in and of itself. How has God revealed himself throughout time? How has he revealed himself today in the church age? But here's the big question, and making it personal. How has God even revealed himself to you in your life, right? And I'm speaking to my brothers and sisters and asking that question. And, I'd ask that question to the atheist and the agnostic too. Because personally, I believe that if we would have our eyes open, we would be able to see God's operation in our life, even if we don't want to believe in him. And so, but are we attuned to that? And are we looking out for it? Are we willing to hold that knowledge in our lives to say, God is alive, okay? So what is God up to? What's he done and what's he doing? And that is the testimony of Stephen. And that should be, even in our personal lives, our testimony as well, too. That God is in operation, that he's at work, and we have a witness and testimony that we can share with others to say, look, God is real. God is alive. And he can be, you know, he can be found if you would search for him. So that's what Stephen does in Acts chapter 7. He speaks very clearly. Look, if you just open your eyes, it's so clear. God has been revealing himself, you know, but are you going to choose to see him? And so we can go back into our lives, and this is what our witness and our testimony should be, even to share with others personally, where it's like, I can tell you personally, here's how I saw God in my own life. And what is true is that he wants to be in the life of every person. You know, in 2 Peter 3:9, it says, God does not desire that any should perish, but that they should come to him, to know him. And so do we have the story that we would hope to be able to share with others to say, man, open your eyes, wake up. You know, God is alive, God is real. And not to say wake up like as a derogatory or like, look, you're blind and you're stupid and you're a fool. It's not like that. It's like if we would open our spiritual eyes, you know, and stop looking at things through just physically, right? Where I've seen so many things happen in people's lives. There are friends of mine who are atheist or agnostic, and I'm like, dude, did you just see what happened in your life? What just happened there? That was not common. That was peculiar, you know. And what I believe was an operation of God in their life. And many times they'd say to me, it was just a coincidence. And I'd say, you know, I don't know. I think maybe you might want to relook that and just consider the possibility that there was something over and above that whole circumstance and that whole event, and it may have very well been God and him trying to speak into your life. But are you willing to listen? Do you want to listen? Or do you just want to call it coincidence and then just go about your life as though, you know, those are just the things that happen sometimes. You know what I'm saying? Okay, so we're going to go to Hebrews 11 now, and I'm going to shorten these up more and more. I'm at 7:29, so now I'm going to try and cut these down to no more than 5 minutes on each. So, and those of you who know me, you're like, good luck, Josh, good luck. this is hard for me. This is really hard. You know, when I try to shorten things up, because as I talk, I really try to listen to the Lord. What do you want me to say? And I hear him saying, I want you to say this. And then I have to step outside of the whole realm of time thing where it's like, well, if I say that, Lord, that's going to take at least 5 minutes to say it right. He's like, yeah, but you say it. You need to say that. All right. Help me, Lord. Can I do this in 5 minutes? Shouldn't matter, though, right? It's how much. Here's another question. How much time are we willing to give to the Lord? How much time are we not willing to give to the Lord? Ugh. All right. I'm asking some convicting questions, aren't I? And don't worry about it. I'm talking to me too. Okay. All right. Hebrews chapter 6. Clint McBroom. Clint, if you check back in later, I'm doing this one because you requested it. Saying Hebrews chapter 6 was one of your favorite chapters and would love to know what the wisdom is applied in this one. The title of it is imitating those who inherit promises. Okay? Imitating those who inherit promises and asking a question, who is this in your life? Okay? So let me read this scripture. Hebrews 6:11 says, we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Okay, so this is connected even to the last wisdom that we did, where Stephen, right, he was a patient man. He was a man worth imitating. And going back, right, Stephen shared this whole historical story of here's, you know, much of what happened in Israel in the time that they were just the nation that they were in the Old Testament covenant. Okay, so what we find when we study the history of Scripture as well is, man, there are a number of individuals who went through some really hard times. You know, we can't, you know, we shouldn't, at least, when we read stories of Scripture, that it's a big deal when God entered into Abraham's life and he said, I want you to move. I want you to leave the place you grew up in, and I want you to leave your family, and I want you to leave everything that you've ever known, and I want you to believe on me. I want you to trust me, and I want you to step into a journey that I'm calling you to, and to go the way that I'm calling over your life. Abraham had no idea whatsoever where God was going to take him and what he was going to do with him, but Abraham believed God, and he walked with God. He was a friend of God, and eventually, not immediately, but over time, he inherited God's promises, where he had a son, and through his son, an incredible nation was born. And man, Abraham, he's in heaven now, inherited fully the promises and the wonders of God, you know, living in heaven. That's, man, that's awesome. And so when we're encouraged in Hebrews 6 that do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises, there are people who went through some things. You know, Moses is another one that immediately comes to mind, where he was in the wilderness for years and years before God called him when he was 80 years old. Okay, could you imagine that? As Americans, like when we're 60 years old, we're hoping to retire and not have much to do left in our life that's actually busy work and laborious work. God called Moses to lead a nation into the wilderness and then lead that nation in the wilderness according to the presence that God had given Moses to lead them with. And if you've read Moses' story, that was not easy. That was not easy. We also find, you know, in the case of Jacob, that's a great story. It doesn't speak as much about his patience, but it should be noted at least that he was a man who continually walked with God, sought God's purpose in his life, and that as he walked that out, he had to be a man who was humbled. He was a man who had to learn to depend on God rather than his own abilities to provide for himself. I think there was some of that in his life going on. You know, just like any other person, had a number of areas that God wanted to work into his life in order to grow him, in order to mature him. And as they walked these things out in faith, there were promises to inherit, right? And living in the time that we're living in right now, man, we've inherited the greatest promise, which is found in Jesus Christ being able to live through faith in him. And we're called, right, to live a life that is also filled with faith and patience, because we're on our way to heaven. If we believed in God, we believed in Jesus, we are on our way to heaven with every second that ticks by. Man, isn't that awesome to think about? That there's never a time that we're not moving forward. The moment we're born on this earth, the moment we've chosen God and chosen to live for him and walk by faith, that we're not getting closer to heaven and the great promise of the inheritance that we're going to receive in heaven. That's another topic, right, that we could cover. What are the things we're going to inherit when we're in heaven? So, faith and patience. We can look back on many lives in the scripture and see how they had faith and patience. And the encouragement to our life is that we would have the same. And so do we. Do we have faith and patience? And the idea of that as we have faith and patience, that there is a promise of inheritance that we gather up, will gather up in time, as we choose to live for God. So there's some hard days to live in faith and patience, but there is a reward, right? There is a reward connected to each of those days. And sometimes that reward is even just simply our character being built up in the Lord, right? When it talks about inheriting promises, what did we cover in 1 Corinthians 13? Here's what love is. Love is suffers long, love is kind, love is so on and so forth. If we really want to genuinely grow into that person who loves not just naturally, right? Because any man or any woman loves, every person in some form or fashion loves. Sometimes it's not a person that they love, sometimes it's a thing that they love, but they love, right? But there's a biblical explanation of what love is. And the question is, do we want to have that kind of love in our lives, which is not a self-centered love, but a love centered on God and centered on loving others? If we ever hope to get there, What's required is faith and patience for allowing God to grow us in those things that we might have them. Not by our own strength and not by our own doing and our own man-made efforts, but of allowing the work of God to enter in and change us and transform us. And that is part of the promise that we inherit, right? Promises inherited. We receive the Holy Spirit. Again, someday we're going to go to heaven. That's awesome. You know, and just like, it's like, thank you, God. There are so many good promises to inherit from you, but I have to choose to pursue them in faith and in patience. Okay, three more. John 15. How much time did I do with that one? 7 minutes, give or take. I did a little bit better, right? All right, John 15 is where we're going to go now, if you want to go there with me. All right, so, and if you want to throw a comment up where you have some a specific chapter you want me to cover, just go ahead and put that up there, and we'll go into that chapter, okay? Also, if you have any prayer requests, feel free to share them. Would love to pray for you before the night is over, okay? I just got to say, I love doing this. I love doing this. You know, there's not any greater purpose in life than the opportunity to communicate God's word, communicate his love and his direction for our lives. So, no, I may not say that a lot, but it really is a blessing. I love it. I hope, and I really hope it blesses you. Okay, Jason Arthur, you asked for John chapter 15, okay? We're going to do verse 11 from John 15. And this is Jesus' words to his disciples, to his people, okay? These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. Now, of course, I want to encourage you to get the context of this chapter, because those are words that you need to make sure you fill in and around, asking the question, well, what are Jesus' words? What is he saying in here? That these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. So let me put it to you this way too. If you want to know some things that Jesus said that we might be able to live into joy, read this chapter, read John chapter 15. I'll give at least one point of what Jesus says, one of the things that he speaks for us to have his joy and to live in his joy. It's simply this, to abide in the Lord, abide in the Lord. John chapter 15 is also the chapter where Jesus says to us, I am the vine, you are the branches, okay? So if we want to live into Jesus's joy, we have to recognize that our joy does not come from our own operation and the things that we would want to do in our life according to our way, but to do things according to his way and his direction. And that as we live according to his direction, we find joy. And here's why we should find joy. Because we're serving a Lord who died for us, who gave his life for us, and who loves us. And I'm talking, when I say Lord, I'm talking the Lord of heaven and earth, right? God who created everything, this world that we are living in right now. It's beautiful, it's incredible, it's majestic. And that's just earth, you know, let alone the wonder of space and the universe and the just everything that is and that we're discovering that it is today. This is one of those areas that should just blow our minds, where it's like, oh man, the Lord of heaven and earth, the creator of all things, loves me so much that he died for me, right? I mean, just things that you could spend your whole life thinking about. And it should never cease to blow your mind. I mean, I think that's very accurate. You know, the love that God has for his creation is immeasurable. And man, that I'll tell you, that's something worth dwelling on. I'm just hearing the Lord say, speak this, say it. There's too many things that people are dwelling on today that the Lord has not wanted them to dwell on. And you know, the world's caught up in a lot of hurt and a lot of pain right now. And again, we should not be blind to those things and unawares. But, you know, Jesus said it very plainly. He said, you know, there's going to be despair in the world. There's going to be sorrow. There's going to be heartache. There's going to be famines and pestilence. And there's going to be hatred and anger. And there's going to be violence. There's going to be theft and looting and stealing. And, you know, the world we live in, you know, proves itself to be a terrible world on some days. And it can be very easy to get our minds and our hearts caught up in the terribleness of the world and the condition that it is in. And, you know, so again, God wouldn't want us to be blind to what's happening in the world. But the Lord doesn't want us to be overwhelmed by where the world is. What He wants us to be overwhelmed with is His presence. And then the hope along with that is we're overwhelmed with His presence. His presence sends us into the world where we would be the ones then to overwhelm it with God's love. And those are the, man, I'm telling, I don't meet many people like that, right? And I'm talking myself here too. I'm not one of them either. I'm seeking it. I want to have it. That I'm so overwhelmed with God's love and joy that I'm not, you know, just some guy that's got his head stuck in the clouds and I'm so spiritual that I'm no earthly good. But, you know, there's people that you meet and they have such an incredible measure of love and joy. You can only but wonder, what is it that got inside of them that made them that way? And I meet people, you know, seldom, that have the presence of God in their lives in such a way that it's like, man, after I met them, wow, I was really encouraged. I was really moved because of who they are in the Lord, and then left with a little bit of a desire myself, you know, in saying, man, that's what I want. That's what, you know, the heart and the attitude and the posture and, you know, and going about living life. So I want to be careful with that, because you can, man, just as much love the Lord, you know, with your life and have His presence in you, but still be going through seasons of challenge and seasons of depression and sadness and sorrow, you know. So, but it's just, there's a refreshment there when you get to meet a person and they're so full of the Lord's joy that it's somewhat life-altering, you know, and causes you to say, you know, I want to have some of that. And what do we, so where do we gain it? Where do we find that? We find that abiding in Jesus. I am the true vine, and you are the branches, right? We find that by grafting our life to Jesus and living after Him for Him. There's never been a day that I regretted living for Jesus, looking back on it and saying, you know, that was a wasted day. You know, it's entirely the opposite. It's, man, if I do feel like a day was wasted, it was a day that I didn't live for the Lord. You know, those are the days that I regret and that I do not have joy. So when Jesus says, I want your joy to be complete, I want you to have fullness of joy, we find that by living in Him and for Him. Okay? So counting on joy through Jesus, and we can find that through His words in John 15. All right, we're going to do one more, Psalm 91, and then we're just going to go ahead and close in prayer. All right, Psalm 91. And this one was requested by two people, both by Linda Pearson. So Linda, if you're on here later, I finally did this psalm. Sorry it took me a while, more than 2 weeks almost. And this one was also requested by Jason. And I didn't look this psalm up, actually, so I have no idea what the wisdom is and what it says. But it's probably good because two different people recommended the same chapter. So Psalm 91, And we're not doing the whole chapter, we're only doing a portion of it. Here's what it says. Okay? So, here's a promise given in the scripture. The tool here in what it's called is safely abiding in the presence of God. So that's cool, actually, because what did we just talk about? Abiding in Jesus' presence. So, okay, there you go. So, starting at verse 3. Surely the Lord, shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler. Okay, now if you don't know what a fowler is, the fowler is the one who catches birds in a trap or a snare. Okay, there's people out there like that in the world. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. Okay? I want us to focus even on that word then, destruction, okay? That even when it comes to the loss of life, if we were to even lose our lives, we could still abide safely in the Lord. Why? Because it is God alone who holds power over life and death. So even if harm were to befall us, which is possible in this world, we began with Acts chapter 7, where Stephen became a martyr. He was stoned by people because he was sharing Jesus with others. So he died. He was persecuted, and he literally became a person who died for his faith. So sometimes people can read scriptures and say, well, that sounds like a contradiction. Right? Because here in Psalms, it's saying that God is going to deliver you from the fowler, from a person who sets a trap in your life. And I've known people personally where a person set a trap for them, they fell into it, and they're a person who loved God, who believed in God, but they fell into this trap, and they were harmed by it. Okay? So this scripture is not saying that you're never going to be harmed. You know, you're never going to have your identity stolen, right? That's a common one today. It's, you know, that a fowler, you know, would seek to steal your identity, which would then they could get into your bank account and steal your money. That's a trap. That's a trap that is set. So that happens in this world. That happens to people. So what's going on here, right? Is there a contradiction in the scripture? You know, because it says the Lord will deliver you from the fowler. From the perilous pestilence, he shall cover you with his feathers. Under his wings, he'll provide refuge for you, okay? So we always need to understand things in a proper context, that we can say these promises hold in authority because of who God is, and that his protection goes also beyond this world. So even if we die, God will deliver us from that as we walk with him and after him. And so there's a very important key connected to this promise. It is a promise given to those who are walking in alignment with God's will, right? Jesus even is our example. So Jesus was crucified. He died on the cross. A trap was set for Jesus by the Pharisees, right? For them to condemn him and then crucify him. So even there's an example where Jesus himself was not delivered by the fowler, as we would, as human beings at least, would have wanted him to see him delivered. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Well, it's because God had a bigger plan in the midst of all of that, right? And so as we grab hold of this promise, we need to have a right understanding behind it. It isn't that we won't suffer trouble in this world or that we can't die by the hands of those who are evil and wicked, but it is true that we will be delivered by those who are wicked. Because even if we die, we are taken into the hand of the Lord, right? And it's a promise that we get to live in as we walk in alignment with God's will, right? Verse 12, actually, if we move a little bit ahead in this chapter, says, in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. So just gonna say it. There's some crazy people out there, and I think crazy is a fair word, who misinterpret the scripture, and they believe things. They literally believe things like you could, you know, dash your foot against a stone, you can tread upon lions and cobras, and God is gonna deliver you from those things because you believe in him. But there's confusion there, right? Because what did Satan say to Jesus? Throw yourself down from the temple, you know, because it says in his word that his angels will, you know, bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Actually, was Satan's words to Jesus. And Jesus says to Satan, do not tempt the Lord your God. So what Jesus was saying in essence there, what he was communicating was, Satan was asking Jesus to do something that was outside of the alignment of the will of God, okay? Satan was saying to Jesus, throw yourself off this temple, right? Now, and then the moment that Jesus did that and he chose to step out of alignment of God's will, right? When that happens, when we do that as well, we can step outside of God's protection in our lives, as we are choosing no longer to live for him, but are allowing outside sources to motivate our decisions, okay? So I'm trying to just give some good understanding and connection of understanding the promises of scripture, because harm can come upon us, it can befall us. But ultimately, right, God is our deliverer. God has the power to deliver, and he will deliver. So we have safety and abiding in the presence of God. And there's so much more that I could say to this, because there is at least this idea that when you abide in the presence of God, okay, so today, right, as a pastor, I'm abiding in the presence of God today, meaning today I chose to wake up this morning, I chose to stick with my family, I chose to sit down actually at the dinner table tonight and have a meal together. And talk about our days and enjoy one another's company. I chose today to get into the Word of God. I chose today to, do ministry work, which my heart's hope is that it was all pleasing to the Lord as I was serving Him. Now, I made those choices, and I abided in the presence of the Lord as I made those choices. Now, I also have the option to no longer abide in the presence of the Lord, where I could say, you know what, tomorrow morning I'm just going to wake up and, you know what, I'm going to go hit Cancun, right? Or, man, I want to go and I'm going to go drink some alcohol and I'm going to go party it up and I'm going to live the teenager's life as a 37-year-old, right? I met some guys like that. They're still trying to party it at an old age. And so if I chose to do those things, I would no longer be abiding in the presence of God. And if I was choosing to pull myself away from my family out of healthy relationships to pursue destructive relationships, I should expect destruction to enter into my life. So same with, you know, if I start drinking alcohol instead of water, I'm inviting destruction into my life. So what I'm trying to get at there is with this safety net, in essence, as well, that when we abide in the presence of the Lord, when we walk in Him and we walk with Him, it also naturally sets up a defense and a shield which comes from God, because we're living a righteous life, which gives us a good protection, right? So, I feel like I just learned something there myself, right? Thinking about it that way. My family that God has given to me is a great defense for my life, to help keep me in righteousness, which then helps keep me out of trouble and away from destruction, where I could bring it upon myself much sooner than planned. Right? So thank your Lord for your families, if you have them, or, you know, for friends as well, for godly friends that encourage you to walk in the way of righteousness and just want to see good for your life and see you make good decisions for your own protection and for your own health. So, all right, there's a little bit of a different thought. And Okay. That's all I got. So it's 8 o'clock-ish, about 3 minutes till by my watch. And I hope you were blessed by this. I hope you were encouraged by it. Man, God's Word has so much good in it for us to learn and to be shielded by, right? I'm telling you, the 5 years that I spent studying this Bible and asking the question in each chapter, what kind of application can I find to live into wisdom that is God-honoring, right? And the way, because God has given us a way in which He wants us to live. And then when we choose to live into that, we receive His blessings. So, do we choose to know it? And if we know it, do we choose to live in it? And as we choose to live in it, we receive the richness of the many blessings. To have joy, we cover. To have a purpose, to live for. Much greater than any that we could ever hope to create ourselves. And much, much more. Much more. Okay, closing thought. We talked about the history of believers in the Old Testament, you know, the saints, how they were called to have a life of faith and patience, be as they would receive a promised inheritance as they live with faith and patience before the Lord. Is that the life that you're living right now? Okay, let's just be honest. Sometimes the Lord wants us to do things that we don't want to do ourselves. You know, we have, just to use some examples, we have television shows that we want to watch. We have, you know, foods that we want to eat. We have, I mean, so many fill in the blanks that could go in here. Things that we would want to do, but the Lord would say, maybe you should take another look at that and what you're allowing into your life, what you're being fed with, what you're allowing into your eyes. And to establish our lives in the Lord in such a way that through faith and patience, that it's like, man, Lord, okay, I believe and I know even that you have a specific will for my life that you want me to live after. And it requires patience and it requires perseverance. It requires effort to actually live into those things because you know my heart and sometimes I don't want to live for those, for the things that you want me to live for. I want to live for what I want to live for. And that's where we have the choice then to cry out to the Lord, help me. Help me to live for what truly matters, for what is truly good, what is right. Because it makes all the difference in the world. It makes all the difference in the world for our lives, and then it can make all the difference in the world, in the lives of others. Because as we choose to live into that life for God, God's presence, God's joy, God's goodness, God's love fills us. And then because it has filled us, now we are able to pour it out on others. It's like, man, don't you want to do that? Right? I'm asking myself that question. Don't you want to do that? Don't you want to pour out God's goodness and God's love on other people's lives? It's only going to happen if you choose to connect with His ways in your life to walk out the life He's called you to. There's not any other way. There just isn't. You know? There is the best life, and it's the life lived in Jesus. Sometimes there's going to be suffering and hardship in that life. But it's so worth it. All right. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for the living wisdom of your word. And that there's never a time that it does not apply to the days that we are living. We just ask that we would have your love in our lives. Not love according to how we would understand it in our frailty and in our humanity, but according to how you've designed it. And thank you for the perfect demonstration of love, which we find in your Son, Jesus. Not only that we have as an example, but that we have ourselves. Because Jesus, you love us. Lord, help us to look back on our history as well, to see your goodness towards us, to see where your operation has been in our lives, and has also even been in history, that we would be able to give a witness and a testimony to the world that you are alive. You were alive then, and you're alive now, today. And Lord, we thank you that every opportunity we have to give to you, that you call in our lives to give an excellent sacrifice to you. Thank you for the wisdom in your word, where you just say to us simply that if we would abide in you, we will find our joy. Help us to know what that means, to be in your presence and to abide in your presence. And once we understand what that is, may we actually live after it and live for it. May you have all the praise and all the glory, and may it be found in our lives as we seek to live for you. May we choose to live for you. We say this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, God bless you. I'm sorry if you commented on here and I did not see your comment. Quite simply, sometimes on Facebook here, I'm just not able to see who has said what. So if you said something, I'll try and engage with you a little later. But God bless you this night. Love your families. Love you. And see you soon.